A little.
There is something else. This bond does give you here no drop of blood. The words expressly are a pound of flesh. Take then your bond. Take then your pound of flesh. But in the cutting of it, if you do shed one drop of Christian blood, your lands and goods are by the laws of Venice confiscate. And to the state of Venice.
Oh, upright judge. Mark Jew. Learned judge. Is that the law?
Yourself shall see the act. For as you urge on justice, be assured, you shall have justice more than you desire.
I take the offer, then. Pay the bond twice, and let the Christian go.
Here is the money.
Soft. The Jew shall have all justice. No haste. He shall have nothing but the penalty. Therefore, prepare you to cut off the flesh. Shed then no blood. Nor cut you less nor more, but just a pound of flesh. If you take more or less than a just pound, be it but so much as makes it light or heavy, in the substance or division of the 20th part of one poor scruple, nay, if the scale do turn but in the estimation of a hair, you die, and all your goods are confiscated.
A second Daniel. Now, infidel, I have you on the hip.
Why just that you pause?
Shall I not have even my prince?
You shall have nothing but your forfeiture. To be so taken at your peril, Jew.
Why then the devil? Give him good of it. I'll stay, no longer question.
Tarry, Jew, the law has yet another hold on you. It is enacted in the laws of Venice. If it be proved against an alien that by direct or indirect attempts he seek the life of any citizen, the party against which he does contrive shall seize one half of his goods. The other half comes to the privy coffer of the state. And the offender's life lies in the mercy of the Duke only, against all other voice.
In which predicament I say you stand?
Down, therefore, and beg mercy of the Duke.
Beg that you may have leave to hang yourself.
That you shall see the difference in our spirit, I pardon you your life before you ask it. For half your wealth, it is Antonio's. The other half shall come to the general state.
Nay, take my life and all, pardon not that. You take my house when you take the prop that doth sustain my house. You take my life when you take the means whereby I live.
What mercy can you render him, Antonio?
Oh, to grant us nothing else, for God's sake.
So please, my lord the Duke, and all the court, forgo the fine of one half of his goods. I am content, so he will let me use the other half in trust. Relinquish it upon his death, unto the gentleman that lately stole his daughter. One thing provided more that for this favor, he shall presently become a Christian.
He shall do this, or else I do recant the pardon I late pronounced it here.
Are you contented, Chu?
I use the term Marano, which refers to the so-called conversos, the Sephardic, that is usually Spanish and Portuguese Jews who were forced to convert to Christianity, and they kept their Judaism undercover, which means that they maintained some beliefs, maintained some elements of the cult even. Overtly, they would be passing for Christians, but deep down, secretly, undercover, that would remain Jews. And I use this image to refer to a certain phenomenon in the 20th century, especially 20th century philosophy, which is connected with a certain group of thinkers of a Jewish origin who came to the middle of philosophy in the 20th century. And like Gershom Scholem, Walter Benjamin, Ernst Bloch, Theodor Adorno, Max Horkheimer, Frankfurt School, then Emmanuel Levinas and Derrida. And they made a very strong intervention in the world of philosophy. And the big problem emerged, that is how to interpret the particular way of thinking. If this is a philosophy, and if this is a philosophy, then we cannot call it a Jewish type of thinking, because philosophy is a universalistic idiom, right? Mm-hmm. And makes no use of any particular language, or simply call it a Jewish thought. But then, why should we call it a Jewish thought? In these thinkers were not particularly confessional. So they usually did not even practice Judaism, right? So from the point of view of a strong religious identification, they were not Jews. And their thinking could not be classified simply as Jewish, like, for instance, Abraham Heschel, Soloveitchiks, or people like that. Even with Levinas, right, the situation was difficult, because the thinking of Levinas was always neatly divided into his Jewish corpus, this is the Talmudic readings, and phenomenological corpus, and usually interpreted completely separately. So I decided that we need a different methodology, simply a methodology of reading this text that would actually allow for interpretation of certain Jewish motifs there. And I used the metaphor of the Maranos in order to explain how, putting things bluntly, our philosophical Maranos practice certain elements of Jewish faith, a Jewish belief, undercover. That is, without betraying it openly.
So you took an image,
making explicitly.
So in other words, you took an image out of the 16th century and applied it to a group of thinkers in the 20th century to show that they had a certain commonality in the way they were thinking.
Yes, and this commonality can actually be very nicely shown, and it can build, in Benjaminian words, a constellation of Marano thinkers who all use Jewish motifs without actually naming it as such. Mm-hmm. And my inspiration actually came from, I always thought that we need something like a special methodology to approach these thinkers in order to make any sense of what they're saying, you know, Adorno, Benjamin, Derrida. their emphasis on the messianism, a different kind of messianism than a Christian one. The inspiration came from three sources. One was Derrida. Derrida, who for the last at least decade of his life insisted on some mysterious secret by saying, you won't really understand what I'm talking about unless you understand my secret. It was almost like telling the secret de pollutionnaire, like you know, the secret is just right there, right? Unearth it, uncover it, and you'll understand everything about me.
The magic key.
Yes, and he called himself in his autobiography a Marano of French Catholic culture. It never really developed much, this auto-identification, but I thought that this is definitely a kind of a clue he's giving us to his secret. And then I read interview with Max Horkheimer in the 60s about the Frankfurt School. This was the time where Max Horkheimer already returned to Judaism. He was one of the founder of the Frankfurt Institute of Social Research. And he was asked by the interviewer just to give a very short, one sentence definition of what Frankfurt School was all about, all this intervention of critical theory, Adorno, Horkheimer himself, the connections with Walter Benjamin, what were they doing? And Horkheimer answered, Judaism undercover. He just gave it this very simple description. And finally, I read Charles Reznikov, who is one of my favorite poets, American Jewish poet, writing in English, but with some echoes of Hebrew and Yiddish in his poetry, who wrote the cycle of the poems called Jerusalem Golden, in which he talks about the Jews scattered all over the world, speaking Hebrew in every language under the sun. It is obviously not speaking Hebrew directly, explicitly, but through every other language under the sun, somehow making it visible, bending the language, bending every idiom in such a way that the Jewish message, the Jewish content becomes somehow visible. Comes to the fore, not explicitly, not immediately, not fully, but still it is there. So I decided to elaborate kind of a new methodology of reading, which I use to Gershom Scholem himself, to Walter Benjamin, to Theodor Adorno, to Derrida, and finally to Levinas, to show that they actually philosophers, that is, they use the universal idiom which is addressed to all of us, but doing in a very special way, that is, with this clear Jewish clinament that bends the idiom of philosophy in a very particular kind of way.
And that bending of the idiom, you've given that a title. You're calling that a crypto theology.
Yes, I'm calling a crypto theology because it is using Jewish theology, both orthodox and heterodox. I mean, in case of Scholem, Benjamin, especially Bloch, it is Lurianic Kabbalah. It's mostly heterodox Jewish tradition. But in case of Levinas, it's orthodox rabbinic Judaism. But it is a theology. It is a theology which invades the seemingly secular idiom of philosophy. And perhaps if it just divulged itself as simply theology or even more Jewish theology, it would be immediately accused of particularism or bending.
Yes.
But in this situation, when it is played out in secret, although the secret, just like in case of Derrida, you know, can be almost on the surface, always there. Actually, what is produced is some kind of a third language, a kind of a hybrid, idiomatic hybrid, which is neither theology nor philosophy, which is neither a religious message nor a purely secular message. Something very interesting in between.